Hello, this is Ander Conal from Playing Concepts Bilbao, here at this country, at Spain. Today we will be talking about pair programming. We have an original title from Star Wars, The Force Awakens, okay? Let's see, for the moment here, who is Ander Conal? This is Ander Conal, and you can follow me on Twitter or on LinkedIn or wherever you want, and you can talk me and ask me questions or whatever you want, okay? Here we have the schedule for today. We will be talking about pair programming, the styles, the benefits, the dangers, the recruitment processes, conclusions, okay? This is more or less the thing. So let's start. First of all, I want to speak about MertinFowler.com. Why? Because when preparing this webinar, I was looking for a lot of articles on the internet, and in my opinion, this is the best article on pair programming right now on the internet. Okay, so this article was written by Birgitta Bockeler and Nina Siesegger. I don't know if I'm pronouncing properly, but I recommend you to take a look to MertinFowler.com and to the article on pair programming. Okay, this webinar is a little bit based on it, but we are using our experience with pair programming for explain to you all this. So let's start. What is pair programming? It's a good question. It's a programming practice, a good programming practice. I think it has a modest adoption right now in the industry. I think a lot of companies are doing pair programming right now, but the adoption is not yet all the fine it could be, in my opinion. Especially here in Spain, I think there are companies which aren't doing pair programming, and I don't like it. They should do pair programming, okay? At least they have to try. And how could we define pair programming? We could say two people working on the same PC at the same time. No more? Well, maybe no more, I don't know. And remember from other webinars, other virtual coffees here at Playing Concepts Online, that we have been talking about extreme programming, XP, and we have mentioned pair programming as a good practice from extreme programming. So it's a good programming practice with a modest adoption on the software industry, at least here at Spain. I suppose that on UK or on United States, maybe the adoption is bigger than here, but I'm not sure about it. And it's something like two people working on the same PC. We will see. And it's a good practice from extreme programming. Okay. And you can take a look to my other webinar about Scrum, Kanban, where we speak about extreme programming. You can take a look there. Okay, now let's see the pair programming styles. Let me drink some water before speak about the next one, or the first one. Driver and navigator. We have maybe the most typical pair programming style. Okay, we have two people, and the first one is the driver, the second one is the navigator. The driver is the one who rides, okay? Takes care of the peripherals, like the keyboard, the mouse, and focuses on what it's doing in that moment. It's writing code, it's thinking on that code. It's not thinking on the big plan, on the big idea, on the big problem. No, he's thinking on what he's writing in that moment, okay? And a really important thing that I think we normally don't do is comment what we are doing while we are the driver. Why? Because we have to explain what we are doing. We have the control. We are the one who rides. So we have to explain. Okay, I'm in here. I want to open this file because I think here we have the implementation of the of this class, and we will use it here in that test, for example. We have to speak all the time. You have to speak all the time. And what about the navigator? The navigator is the one who observes, okay? The driver is writing, and the navigator is observing. Here is a danger. There's a danger. What's the danger? I think some buses here, and especially maybe here on Spain, who think that pair programming is a waste of time and of money, because they see the navigator and they say, wow, I'm paying this guy to observe. What? Okay, it's fine, but the navigator is not only observing, it's rewriting the code in life. Okay, it's taking a look to the code, what is writing the driver, why is writing this the driver, and it's sharing all the time ideas about the code right now. It's giving directions like, okay, go here, I think we should be there, I think the next step is thinking all the time about the big picture. The driver is focusing on the moment, on what he is doing right now. But the navigator, no. The navigator is taking care about the big picture, next steps, potential bugs, this direction, the other direction. Maybe you are doing something which is not helping us to achieve the goal. Okay, so that's the main difference right now between the driver and the navigator. Take care and try to do what we are doing or saying right now with those two roles on pair programming. Okay, what's fine about driver and navigator? We have two different perspectives about the code. You know, when you are alone, there's possibly only one perspective until you review the code with another teammate, for example. But at the moment you are doing pair programming, you have two different perspectives all the time. I think, by my experience, that this should be made this way. I think no. Well, the driver will have a more tactical perspective. The details. The important for the driver are the details right now. The small details. Maybe what I'm writing, how to call this function, how to write this name. You know, and the navigator will have a more strategic perspective, observing from outside. When you think, for example, on a famous film, Gladiator, for example, with Russell Crowe, the driver will be Russell Crowe fighting there, and the navigator will be the emperor. I don't know what's the name of the actor. Right now, but because he's observing from outside on the horse and is taking a look to the battle and thinking about the strategic in a strategic way from outside to see, oh, take care, they are arriving from here, from the north, take a look, they are arriving from here, and you are here, take a look, and the driver is there fighting, bam bam bam, with the detail of the battle. Okay, so that's the main thing to think about the driver and navigator. The driver, tactical mindset, strategic mindset for the navigator, okay? And here are some recommendations for the driver and the navigator. Not start pair programming until you have a well-defined task. This is important for everybody. If you don't do pair programming, you shouldn't be starting until you have a well-defined task. But maybe when you do pair programming, you should take special care about the defined task. Okay, so please, well-defined tasks. If you're interested on how to define a good task, we can try to translate our previous webinar about the backlog and how to take care of it. Okay, we can do it. Right now it exists, but it's in Spanish. We have to set the focus on a small goal each time. A small goal each time. And both people, the two on the pair, have to know what is the goal, which is the goal we want to achieve with the pair programming session. We don't have to start, oh, let's write code, it's fine. Oh, yeah, it's pretty. No, a goal, a small goal, it's time. Okay? It's a good idea to change the roles, okay, regularly. And so the navigator will turn on a driver and the driver will turn on a navigator. And both have to write, have to focus, have to think. You know, you have to be changing to avoid some of the dangers we will talking about later. Okay, change. And the navigator will avoid tactical thinking. Okay, the details are for the driver. You have to think from outside the bigger picture, yeah, on the medium long term. Next steps, obstacles, ideas to argue about once a small goal has been reached. Things like those, okay? That's important too. Don't start arguing about something which is not near of the goal we have, okay? If it's something to argue about, maybe in the future, once the small goal has been achieved, okay? Okay, let's continue with another pair programming style. Right now we have the ping pong, you know? Pop, pop. We have the ping pong. Ping pong. It embraces the test-driven development (TDD). We will do another webinar or virtual coffee or whatever, another talk, online talk, about TDD in the future here of King Concepts. And it is also TDD a good practice from extreme programming. So doing pair programming with the ping pong style is to embrace the test-driven development. Okay, TDD. It's an ideal style for really well-defined tasks. It can be developed via TDD because not all the tasks can be developed via TDD, in my honest opinion. Something like large code base with legacy code, really, really old. Maybe it's not a really good idea to start with TDD, or yes, maybe you have to start with TDD, doing maybe integration test instead of unit test, because it's really difficult to unit test some legacy code. But, well, my recommendation is to start with ping pong style when you have a really well-defined task with an acceptance criteria and with things to where you can test the story in an easy way to start with it. Okay, so it's really easy. Ping. The first one, the developer A writes file and test. And now comes the pong. Pong. Developer B writes the implementation and makes the test pass. Now the developer B writes a new test, which is filing. And developer A writes the implementation and makes the test pass. Easy, no? Yes, it is. Each pong can be accompanied by another good practice of extreme programming, refactoring. Yes, you know about refactoring? I think yes, you should. Pair refactor before continue with the new test. So you can do the implementation, you can make the test pass, but before start with a new file and test, you can refactor, do a pair refactor, okay? For example, we have here the red-green refactor approach. We have a red test filing on the pong, we make the implementation and we make it pass, so it is green. And later, before I start with the next, we refactor, okay? Remember ping pong and the red green approach. it's a good combination. I recommend it. We have here another style, a strong style pairing. Okay, let me ring or perfect. It's a really good style for the knowledge transfer and only follows one rule, which is really important. If you have here an idea and you want the idea to go to the computer, to your program, it has to go there using the hands of other programmer, not yours. Okay? So, if you think something, you have to be able to explain it to someone who should be able to write the code you have in your mind. And that's the only rule for this strong style pairing style. So we have here that the navigator is normally the most familiar person with the technology, the code, the designs, whatever. Normally, the person with more experience, but on the technology, on the task, or on the designs. Not necessarily the more experience in years. It's not the important thing here. We are talking about the technology. We are talking about the task, about to know what the domain does or what the designs, okay? And the driver is normally the one with less experience, but, whoa, once again, less experience with the code, with the tools, with the designs, okay? It's really important, this difference. It's not about years of experience, but about experience with the code base, with the technology, with the tools, you know? The driver should trust the navigator, should not be upset because of the lack of understanding of some parts of decision, because the idea is on the mind of the navigator right now. On the mind of the one who knows about the domain, about the technology, about the stack. So we should not be all the time trying to explain and taking breaks to explain everything on the detail. No, the driver should trust the navigator and continue. And later, once finished the small goal we have achieved, we can speak, we can argue, whatever, but later, once we have achieved the goal, okay? And this style is really useful for onboarding new partners and for knowledge transfer, okay? The recommendation is don't overuse it, and the idea to know if this style is working or not is to change the roles in the short term, okay? If, for example, you are there doing a strong style pairing and you realize that you have been doing it 1 month ago with the same person, with the same code base, you change the roles and the other person is not able to take the role of driver, of navigator, you probably have a problem. Okay, the idea is to change roles in short term. Okay, and now we have, I think this is the last one, but I'm not sure. We have here the pair development. I think this style is something we do day by day, but we do not know that we are doing pair programming because, well, let's see. Because this is not a technique, but it's a way of thinking. That's the thing. That's the reason, because we don't know we are doing pair programming if we do pair development. But what is the goal here? The goal is, okay, let's do this user story. What should we do to achieve the goal, to have the story as done and in production? We have to program and nothing more. We have to code, nothing more. No, we have to define the story. We have to search on Google on Stack Overflow. We have to think about the user story. We have to do things. We have to do a lot of things apart from code. So once we are doing pair development, we are responsible of everything on the story, everything. Maybe we have to talk with another department. Maybe you have to talk with the design team, maybe with the marketing team. That is part of the story. And you as a peer are responsible for that story, okay? So we have here some examples. Pair development, understand the problem. Yeah, you should understand the problem to finish a task. You should understand it before. Well, you should know, you must understand the problem. You must find the solution. Normally you don't have only one solution, you have multiple solutions. You have to choose between multiple solutions. So you have to be able to find a good solution. You have to plan your approach. You have to investigate and explore. You have to document things. So this is pair development. I'm sure you are doing it day by day with your teammates. And you didn't think, oh, this I'm doing pair programming. No, I'm doing normal things, normal stuff on my day by day. Okay, so you are doing pair programming, pair development. Yeah, you are doing it. It's really simple, but it's really important for us to understand as programmers that a user story includes a lot of more tasks than just write code. Programmers normally like to code and nothing more. No, I do not want to talk with the client. No, I don't want to talk with other departments. No, I hate other people. No departments. Go outside here. No, we have to be all together and be able to do all those things. Understand the problem, find the solution, plan your approach, investigate and explore, document, talk with other departments, everything. Okay. And now we have finished with the style. And we will start with the benefits of pair programming. Okay, there are a lot of benefits, but be careful because there are a lot of dangers too. Let's start with the first one, very, very important, the knowledge transfer. It prevents the knowledge silos. Before do or prepare this talk, I didn't know about the knowledge silos. I'm not sure if this is the correct way to say this, but it prevents knowledge silos. It's really important. If you are on your company and there is only one person who know about a piece of code or about a part of an application, for example, Ander Conal have been developing the grid of this application. He is the only who knows how to that horrible grid works, because Ander is, wow, is a really good programmer. And he only knows how to fix things there. Oh, no, it's not a good idea. What if Ander dies tomorrow or now while I'm talking? What if Ander goes to another company tomorrow? What if Ander gets sick? No. And with pair programming, we prevent that. We prevent the knowledge silos. Okay. Another important thing is that we have, oh, sorry. we have two minds understanding, discussing a problem. So you're increasing the possibility to find a good solution. Okay, but because normally when you're alone, you have that solution and you say, oh, I think it's the best and nothing more. Oh, I will do it. But probably it's not the best. Probably there are other solutions better than yours. Or probably there are other solutions similar than yours, but with some small changes, they could be better. And we have very important different experience and perspective about the code, and we are able to consider more alternatives than if I'm alone. Maybe my experience is only, for example, with front-end languages. I have teammates who have experience with front and back-end languages, and he had a good idea. Okay, Ander, I have an idea. I think it's better than yours. And my experience says that it's better because blah, 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 blah. And I say, oh, good point. I like it. Let's do it this way. It's better than mine. Let's do it. This is a really, really good thing for the knowledge transfer and for pair programming, okay? There we have here the reflection. With pair programming, we are forced to discuss solutions. This is, I think, a really important thing here, because sometimes you feel like, I'm not doing pair programming, he's writing all the time the code, I'm not writing, this is boring and I'm stupid and he's better than me and whatever. But suddenly you have to discuss something, you have to discuss a solution, and you are discussing it by 1 hour, 2 hours, and you arrive to a conclusion and you decide something together. That is the good thing. Not to write some words. Okay, bar, whatever, equals, whatever, semicolon. No. The good point is to discuss solutions, to find a good solution together, and you are doing a very good pair programming this way too. Okay? And more important, and this happens sometimes when you are working alone and you suddenly have a problem and you explain the problem to your partner. For example, oh, I have a bug here, I don't know what the fuck is happening, I will explain you, and you start to explaining. Okay, this is a well, and suddenly we realize that we really understand the task, and we realize, maybe we realize on the bug itself, and we say, oh, I said no, well, it was this, oh, sorry, and the teammate doesn't do anything. Is everything here? You are talking, but you are explaining, you are forced to explain things. So with pair programming, as you are forced, we achieve this goal. We have really understood the task after explaining it, okay? And this not only applicable to the code. I always say the same. It's not all everything about code. You have to write the stories, user stories. You have to define it. You have to do acceptance criteria. You have to define the value for the final user. You have to think on a lot of things, okay? The focus, take care of this, because I think it's part of the dangers too. But well, right now we are with the benefits, so let's only think on the good stuff. When you're not alone, it's easier to focus. When you're alone, if we are honest, we have, I don't know how to say it, but we have the ability to distract us with everything. Oh, see, there is a cat there. Oh, that's awesome. Oh, let's see. There. Oh, there is a pink star there. Oh, well, what's up here? It's awesome. And you, we have a really good ability to distract us with small things with no importance when we are alone. Oh, let's take a look to the Twitter. Let's see if Andre Conal is talking about something interesting. And when we are pair programming with another mate, the it's really easy to focus, because you have another person here and you have to focus. You can't be with another person and start, you are writing code and suddenly you say, oh, wait a moment, mate, I will take a look to the WhatsApp and later I will take a look to the Twitter and link it into. Wait a moment, I'm here. Okay. What? I'm just 1 minute. No. Normally we focus. It's easy to focus, okay? And another good reason to focus is that it's part of the peer, have to say what it's doing and why. You can't start doing things here as driver, for example. Code. You cannot start writing code without communicate, as we have been saying at the start of the talk. You have to explain everything, because the navigator will be taking a look from here and saying, what the fuck is doing under? It's writing things. I don't know what it's doing. And the same for me as navigator. I have to communicate. I have to see. I have to say, hey, I think you should not be here doing that, because we won't achieve the goal if you continue with that part. We can go there later, man. Let's continue, okay? And that's why we have the we have to say what we are doing and why And if the why is not helping us to achieve the goal, the partner can say, hey, no, let's go with this other way. No, here, here, yeah. Okay, so it's really important, the focus, but it's dangerous, you will see later. The peer review in life, we can do another webinar about peer reviews if you want. I have been reading a series of blog posts from Microsoft, I think, or from Microsoft, and they have been talking about their peer review style, and I think it could be a good webinar or virtual coffee if you would like to hear me talking about it. Just write a comment and we can take a look on it. Okay, but the thing is, peer review, we normally work alone and we say, oh, let's work alone, and later I do a peer review if we do. But with peer programming, you are doing a peer review in life. It's awesome. We have 4 A's instead of 2, reviewing each line of code. It's detailed. It's awesome. In life, it's wow. And refactoring is part of peer programming. If something is wrong, you will change it on the fly. You won't wait until you go to your peer and you do a peer review. No, no, no. You will redo it right now at the moment, because you are with your partner and your partner say, hey, Ander, what the fuck are you doing? What the fuck are you doing? Let's refactor that. That is really, really bad stuff. No, 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 no good idea. Let's continue. Let's refactor. Okay. Other way, without peer programming, you will be waiting to finish the task. Maybe it's a really big task. Okay, I brought hundreds of or whatever, and you go there, you do the peer review, and boom, big bomb. We have 2 ways of thinking combined, the tactic and the strategic. So could an individual combine both? I think no, and not at the same time. That's the important thing. You could be really good thinking tactically, you could be really good thinking strategically, but I think you could not be really good thinking both styles at the same time. It's impossible. You only have one brain. You should not believe. You should not believe on the multitask on the human brain. We can talk about it too, but it does not exist. No, it does not exist. Okay, let's continue. It unifies both ways of thinking. Will increase code quality, of course. We have 2 ways of thinking, okay? And if you're alone, you will have the tactic, the strategic, or maybe first you are thinking tactically or later strategically. You don't know. Maybe first strategic, later tactic. But with pair programming, if you are doing it well, you are thinking all the time with both brain techniques, okay? Oh, really important, the collective code ownership. It seems like a post from this blog. The continuous practice of pair programming ensures its line of code have been touched by at least 2 people. So if Ander have started to write a really, really, really good grid for an application, and Ander goes out on vacation on holidays, for example, or Ander gets sick for 2 months, what happens with that grid? Maybe someone for brain cancer scans takes a look to my code and say, oh my god, Ander is the worst on the planet. This is shit of code. I don't know where to do it. Oh, this is legacy code. I don't like it. But with pair programming, Ander and the other teammate have been 2-3 weeks doing that code, and at least another teammate knows where to do it, where to start, where to refactor, you know, where to find bugs. So it's really important, and the collective code ownership, and it facilitates each member of the team to be comfortable touching anything in the code. We are both things like, oh no, 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 I want to write that part, is dangerous. I have not touched it, oh, I think 3 months ago, I don't know where. there should be a monster or something like that. I won't do it. No, you have been pair programming with all the team all the time, so you know what is there and you are able to touch there without any type of fear. Okay? Oh, really important. We have been talking on it about this when we have been talking on about the backlog on another webinar on playing concepts. About the work in progress and the importance of maintaining a low work in progress. So, if we are four in the team and we work individually, we will have four tasks at the same time and probably another four on test, because programmers are this way. I'm sorry. Yeah, we are. And with pair programming, we have one advantage, at least one, that we will be pairing. So, instead of four, we will have two tasks on each goal. So the work in progress has been decreased. Yeah, by 50%. It's really incredible. We only have pair programming, and we have 50% less work in progress. Awesome. So really important, maintains a low work in progress. So we can focus more on the important tasks. Maybe if we have to start at the start of a sprint with four tasks, we are taking one task which is not important. But if we start only with two, maybe at the end of those two tasks, we have a new task which is the most important at the moment, and we can take it instead of be working on another which is less important. Okay? Really important too, the onboarding is really fast with pair programming. In my experience, for example, here in playing concepts, when I started here, I didn't need anything about testing. Zero. Zero. I didn't know anything about backend. Zero. And what happened? I started doing pair programming all the day, strong style programming with my partner, Eder Elorriaga. I think we have been pair programming like 6 months from the beginning, and it was incredible. After those 6 months, I have been able to touch all parts of the code. I have been able to do tests, to do backend, to do everything, and I have been able to take care of that project alone without my partner. Yeah, and it was thanks to the pair programming, a strong style programming in this case, because he had all the knowledge about the domain, about the designs, about the technology, about everything. Well, about everything. So it's really important, and minimize the impact of the onboarding of new employees. Please, with new employees, do pair programming and do a good pair programming. Say, hey, you will be the driver, I will be the navigator. Hey, let's change the roles. Hey, let's think about the big picture. Hey, you have to focus on right. Do it well, and do it with on your onboarding process. We start with the dangers right now. Okay, pair programming. This is really true. Pair programming can be exhausting. I can say it personally. Those 6 months I have been talking about in the previous step were really, really exhausting. We were all the time doing pair programming, all the time, with all the focus. We both were new for each other, and we were like 6 months, day by day, eight hours a day, only taking a break to lunch, and it was really exhausting because I think we didn't realize that we have to change roles more regularly. We have to take breaks more regularly. We have to do some things that right now I know, but on that time I didn't need. Okay, and I think that was our error. So I was really exhausted, and my partner too. So take care, because when you work alone, you take breaks, little breaks. You don't think on them. It is like natural. No, you are here, and you say, "Well, I will go one moment to fill this a bottle of water." Yeah, and you go to the kitchen. You take water. Okay, I will sit down again. Okay. Well, I will take a break to take a sumo, for example, an orange juice. I don't know. I will take a look to the WhatsApp. I will take a look to the Twitter. But when you do pair programming, take care of it, because it can be exhausting. You are all the time with your partner, okay? Because it forces you to stay focused for longer and find breaks. This the important thing that match the couple's way of thinking and the rhythm is not easy. Maybe your partner is a person who like to code all the time, like 4-5 hours continued, and you need to take breaks every 1 hour, for example. It's really difficult to find a solution that match the couple's way of thinking. So it's really difficult, but you have to find it. And so it can be very intense and exhausting. So take care and think on it and think on me. Sander have told me it could be exhausting and it is. Interruptions due to meetings. Well, we can do a really big talk about this, about interruptions and meetings on this new world. But well, let's focus on the talk. But imagine you have meetings at that hour, at 1 o'clock, and your partner have another meeting at 2 o'clock. So you have an interruption at one, an interruption at two. And what if you have 2, 3, 4 meetings? Horrible. Believe me, it's horrible. So be careful with the meetings and the interruptions. And not only the meetings, you can be in your side. And comes another teammate, a third teammate, and says, "Hey, Ander, one moment, Ander, please, Ander, yes, what do you want? Well, this is an interruption to you, and you have a partner there." So take care of interruptions and try to go async. Take a look to the async manifesto. I really like it. I think it should be replacing the agile manifesto, in my honest opinion. And take a look to the async manifesto and you will see that it will avoid this kind of problems. Another problem is the different labels between programmers. Okay, we can take for granted how far it can go. For example, we are doing a strong style programming and I think my teammate is something like a ninja, or I don't know why, how to say it, a really good programmer, the 10x programmer, the best programmer in the world, and suddenly he stops writing or thinking and say, "I don't know." And in my mind I'm thinking, oh, he was a ninja programmer, he's thinking, because I took for granted how far he could go with the code. But no, he can have vulnerabilities. He can be not that good on, for example, one technology or whatever. It makes frustration due to difference in rhythm. Okay, maybe, especially when we are doing a strong state programming and one person have really, 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 really small experience. And the other one have too much experience, what happens? Maybe the one with less experience is saying, "Whoa, I'm frustrated. He's doing a lot. I am not doing anything. I'm the worst programmer in the world. This is horrible. I have to go to other company because this is not my side. He's a god. I can't do the same than..." You know, so take care with it. It doesn't happen anything. So you are doing a strong state programming, yes, because you have to learn. You have to learn. Okay, so it's totally fine if he's doing 10 times your work. Yeah, it's fine. This is the way. Okay, it's correct, but take care of it, because we normally are frustrated because of the difference in rhythm. This is another danger, and this is why previously we have been talking about, hey, take care of it. You have to have a well-defined task, task. Why? Because if we start with pair programming with a lot of uncertainty, we will have problems. Okay, experimenting, searching can be frustrating again. Each person learns at a different pace and in a different way. So if you start something which is not well defined, you will start to search on Google, on Stack Overflow. On the other hand, you will see a course, a video course, another person maybe will be to a partner and will ask, and it won't be, well, maybe it could be pair development, but then you have to be really, really serious with it and say, we are not doing a driver navigator style pair programming. We don't do it a strong style programming. We are doing pair development and we are investigating. After investigate and define the task, we will start with the driver navigator style. That's the point, you know? You can do other things, but take care. Don't think you are doing the driver navigator if you haven't. You have uncertainty, okay? Well, you don't have time for yourself because each one has their habits. It's not true. You like to listen music. You like to stop and take a look to a course. 30 minutes each day. But with pair programming, this is very complicated. It's not easy to, hey, what happens if I say, hey, I will stop to listen music. I like to listen Holland hardcore music. And the partner say, hey, what are you doing? No. I like to listen to rock. Oh, no, I want hardcore. No, I want rock. No. And what about, hey, wait a moment, I will go to do a course for 30 minutes. See you later. No, you are doing pair programming. You have to match or take a decision with your partner and say, hey, let's, for example, let's stop every 1 hour for another hour and let's listen music alone and later let's return. Or, hey, what if we learn... if we listen to this kind of music, which is fine for both, for example. Okay, so take care of the time for yourself and look for it. Look for it. Don't start, oh, let's pair programming for 4 hours together. No, right. Let's decide what to do and how each one could do something for himself. Okay. Oh, context change. Yeah. Another danger. It's here. Why? Imagine that you start pair programming and you do a front-end task with the grid. We have been talking about the horrible grid I have developed. Oh, under so the worst programmer in the world. And you do pair programming on the afternoon with another teammate, and you go from the grid to, for example, to the header of the application. But later, in the next day, you go with the backend people and you do some backend stuff. What happens here? Context, 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 cut, cut, cut. So take care, okay? It's really difficult sometimes to say no, but sometimes you have to say no and you have to planning. You have to planning and say, hey, today will be the backend day. Let's do backend things, some programming. And tomorrow will be the grid day. Let's do this with the grid. And this afternoon, I will be all the afternoon with the header. Let's focus on the header, but focus planning on one thing each time. Remember the small goals, please. Don't do, yes, I'm with the header. Wait a moment, I will go to the grid. Wait a moment. Okay, I brought some code on the grid. Oh, hello. Let's continue with the header. Yeah. Oh, yeah, let's do the backend. No. Avoid context things, please. Focus time. 1, 2, 3 hours. Continuous focus time each day on a goal at a time. Whoa. This is a really good point. Pair programming requires showing your vulnerabilities, okay? Pair programming forces us to share everything. We know but also what we don't know. It's really easy to do a task alone, and suddenly you don't know something, and you go to Stack Overflow, or you call a teammate, or whatever, and you finish the task, and you do a peer review. Your peer won't know what you have been copying from Stack Overflow. The peer won't know what are you missing on that task. He will see a complete task, finish it, and it could think, oh, Ander knows everything about everything, it's really fine. But the reality of pair programming is that you are writing code and oops, I don't know how to continue. It's fine, you don't know how to continue, and you are saying to your peer, I don't know how to continue, maybe we have to investigate, maybe we have to do pair development and research a little bit. I don't know anything about this technology, do you know? Yes, I know. I will help you. Okay, let me be the driver and you will be the navigator. Let's do a strong state programming and take care of the keyboard. And I will be here as navigator and I will say you, oh, the big picture is that. Okay, that's the important thing. You will have to show the vulnerabilities, and not all people are ready to say, I don't know. Okay, but I think it's fine. We can't know everything about everything. Oh no, I'm full stack. Oh, perfect. So you will know how to do this on the cloud with this. No, I don't know. Oh, so you're not a full stack. Yes, I am. I have been working on the server, on the DevOps part. I have been working on the front end. I have been on JavaScript item, but I don't know about that small part. I can learn, but I don't know. And it's nothing wrong with it. So it can be hard to say, I don't know, but please, there is no problem. Say, I don't know. It's fine. We have here the imposter syndrome, the 10x engineer, and those kind of things, which are not really, really fun. Because if you are thinking that you have a ninja here, oh, this is the best programmer I have been watching in a decade. It's awesome. You won't say, I don't know this. I'm sorry. No, you will be like, you will take your phone and you will be taking a look here at Stack Overflow. Oh, let's see it. No, please say, I don't know. I'm sorry. Let's learn. It's nothing bad about it. And this, I think, is the last danger pair programming can have. It causes that people who have never done it accept it, from the boss to a new teammate. If they have never done it, they won't accept it, because it's like two people at the same time, the same PC, is a waste of time, of money. It's like a shit. No, I won't apply to my company. No. But take care of it. Okay. Well, it's fine. Maybe if that's the case on your company, you have to show this video to your boss and try to compete. The thing is that you should not force anybody to do pair programming. You have to convince them. You have to show the benefits and the dangers. Why is important to know the dangers? To avoid them. Okay? But don't start directly, well, come here, let's do pair programming, strong state programming, because I have been watching to Ander Conal and he said you have to do a strong state. No. We have to think on it and we have to convince other people showing benefits. And what will be the benefits for the company, for the project, for the people itself? And if you both are fine with that decision, then go and do it. Okay? And we have here another point on this channel, pair programming in the recruitment process. Okay. We have been doing technical interviews for a long time, and well, personally, we on Plan Concepts Bilbao, we don't do a technical interview itself. We don't make the interviewee write code, but we ask questions, okay? But there are other companies which have a second or third step where you have a session of live code, for example, with someone of the company here on your arm here, and others they send you a problem to solve and they say you have 5 days, you have to send me solve it in 5 days, please. Okay, I'm talking about that kind of technical interview. Okay, I think it's not a bad idea, but we have to take care about it. We have to avoid all the dangers because it's an interview. Please take care of it. Maybe you are saying no to someone who is a really good programmer because you are doing a bad technical interview. Okay. Here I have some examples. They are only examples, but for example, if the interviewee has never done pair programming, please don't start with ping pong style programming, for example. Do a strong style pairing, okay? And be the one who is the navigator because you have the knowledge of the code base and do pair development. If the interviewee has little experience with the language and or the technology, again, do a strong style pairing. Sorry, don't do ping pong, for example. Don't do driver navigator. Why? He don't know about the language. He don't know about the technology. It's the first day he's with you. Why are you doing the other kind of pair programming? Do a strong style. Do pair development. And if the interviewee has experience with TDD and with the language, yeah, do ping pong. Let's see if really he has experience with TDD and with that language or technology. And of course, always pair development. And what if the interviewee has experience with the language, but not with TDD? Okay, in that case, let's do driver and navigator. And let's see how he drives. And later, let's change the roles. And let's see how he observes from outside and think on the big picture. And let's do pair development. It's totally fine. But if you see on all examples, I recommend to add the pair development part because with pair development, you can see more than code. You can see how things about this user story, about the acceptance criteria, about solve a problem, about find a solution, about explaining an approach, about a lot of things that are not code, because in this job, it's not always about code. It's about a lot of things we do day by day. Okay, so this way with pair development, you will see beyond the code. Maybe the people, the person is nervous because you are looking here and is nervous and the code, well, is not very good, but it's awesome how he's thinking, how he's taking care of each detail, not of implementation only, but on the user story itself, on the problem solving. It's really important. Apply the pair development when you can. And please explain well what style we are going to use and what role will have each one. Hello, Ander. We will do a technical interview doing pair programming. You will be the driver and I'll be the navigator. You will be focused on the code and I will be focused on the big picture. In 30 minutes, we will change roles and you will be the navigator and you will help me writing the code as a driver. Okay, Ander, we will do a strong style programming. I will be the navigator. You will be the driver. You have to turn my ideas into code, please. I will explain my ideas and you have to turn them on code. For example, and please do not base your decision 100% on the result of this step because of nerves and other factors, play tricks, please. And this part, this slide, it wasn't on my Spanish talk about pair programming, but I have added it 2 days ago because I really liked this new post about tech sector job interviews assess anxiety, not software skills. It talks about that a technical interview with pair programming in person, pair programming with a person here looking for what you are doing, what is testing is your ability to assess the anxiety the situation is doing on you, not the technical skills. Maybe you are nervous, like, oh my god, if I press and it don't compile, they will kill me. Oh my god, he's looking for me all the time. Oh, he knows a lot and I don't know anything. I'm the worst. I don't know. And so sometimes take care. We are testing the anxiety of the interviewee instead of the technical skills. Think on it. And we have another one about the stress. Does the stress impact technical interview performance? They say yes. So take care. Maybe you are testing how that interviewee works with stress, but you are not looking for that. You are looking for technical skills. So maybe there are other ways. Or maybe if you explain well what style, what role, and the expectations you have, you could be able to say, hey, say goodbye to the anxiety, say goodbye to the stress, because I have explained it to you. This is the role you will have. This is what I expect from you. So don't worry. It's totally fine. Let's continue. And maybe a good idea is to say, you have this task, please do it from your home alone and send me. Nothing more. Is another solution. I don't know. We have a lot of solutions. I always say, think, test, try new things. For example, let's do pair programming, but let's do it in silence. Let's use Visual Studio Live Share. Let's pair program here, but let's do it without talk. Or talking only for dubs. Like, hey, sorry, I want to, where you have located the file for whatever. But let's do it to the candidate. Okay, slowly. So depending on the person you are interviewing, pair programming could cause anxiety and stress. So maybe you are testing that they are not used to work on a wide work in a front on an audience, nothing more. Maybe you are not testing the technical skills, but you are testing that person have been programming for 5-10 years alone or doing pair programming with a teammate who knows, but knows not working on a wide world in front of an audience. It's different. My opinion is only an opinion. Test, try new things. I'm with you. But take care of the recruitment process. And well, we have here some conclusions about the pair programming. And what's the main conclusion? Pair programming is fine. Okay, bye-bye. No, it's fine. Why? Because well used is very powerful and gives us many benefits. Okay? And now that we know the dangers, we should be able to avoid them. Okay? And always we have to use it in combination with other good practices, like a good planning, okay? As I always say, do not stick to the letter, okay, with the styles or the way to do it. Combine various styles, try them separately, choose one, choose two, do one first, another one later. Invent a new one and call me under. I have a new one. You have to do a new talk and explain it. Do whatever you want, but please do not stick to the letter. Do not say, okay, under have said a strong standard programming is the best, so I will be doing it for 10 years. No. Try strong state programming, try pair development, try ping pong, try driver navigator, check roles. Please test everything. Use the one which is the best for you, which fits your needs, and If you're able, invent a new one and let's talk about it on Twitter or LinkedIn or whatever. So thank you all. See you here at Playing Concepts. I'm under Conal, Twitter, LinkedIn, I think Facebook too, I'm not sure. And well, see you next time. Thanks a lot.